Welcome back to the channel, guys. I am joined again by Scott Wallner. I had a lovely first conversation with Scott, which I hope you will have checked out because I think it will be important to watch that one in order to watch this one. But if not, it's all good because we'll go on a lot of tangents and we'll go everywhere and nowhere. So, gonna have some fun. Before we started, Scott read out some of his notes to me and they seemed extremely exciting. So, why don't you lead us off?
All right. Yeah, I think we've already passed back a few notes, and this is a problem that I have, and people that I talk to or people that I know sort of have to help me refine which notes we're gonna go from because I have far too many notes and maybe don't go deep enough into all of them. But yeah, for us today, Lucas, I had deep triads is something that I thought we could get interested in, and then also a sort of phrase that at this point is just meaningful for me because nobody else really knows about it is these steep fences, intellectual steep fences. So take your pick. It's
I'll take
50-50.
the second one.
Okay,
Second one
steep
first.
fences. Okay, so this is a this is just a way that I think about essentially navigating paradoxes or questions in general, I guess. So the first thing I guess to point out is that a fence divides two things. It's a sort of boundary between two things. And if you think about the landscape on either side of the fence, now you can sort of map that quite easily onto there's a sort of landscape of possibility or potential on one side and a landscape of possibility and potential on the other side. So it's just a sort of visual or imaginal, analogy for us to sort of have for ourselves. And so you could sort of apply this to any type of decision or choice that you might need to make if you want to simplify it down to a sort of a dichotomy, right? So I'm not implying that all decisions or all thinking or all sort of reasoning or intellect should be boiled down to a dichotomy, but I think it's often very possible for us to do that. And there is some usefulness in that, except that it comes with the sort of reality of the trap that you put yourself in when you dichotomize something.
Yeah.
That makes sense so far?
No, for sure. I mean, frameworks are always like they're useful and they're almost necessary, I'd say. And you're gonna lose a bit because it's not exactly reality, but that's great. Like, please, I want to hear more.
So I totally agree. There's a sort of and I think this is maybe something that is very deep in the way that thinking beings experience their world is this sort of necessity to simplify and dichotomize, even though we accept that it's sort of pulled back, it's abstracted, it's too simple for what is actually out there most of the time. And so, yeah, I just like to think about these different paradoxes. Some paradoxes are fences that are so steep and tall that it requires a ton of work in order to get from one side to the other. So now we can start to essentially quantify how difficult a paradox or a question is by visualizing fences that are really tall or really short. So, for example, a simple arbitrary decision like, do I want chocolate or vanilla ice cream for my dessert? That's a really short fence that you can just easily step over, right? To get from one side to the other, sort of rationalize it or, even put your belief in one side or the other of what you want or what you think is right is very easy. But there are other deep paradoxes, going all the way to the mind-body problem and, things like Zeno's paradox or the Gödel, paradoxes. these things require a lot of effort to change sides. And the reason that I like the fence imagery is we have this phrase, this colloquial phrase of sitting on the fence about something.
Yeah.
Have you heard that?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it means like you're indecisive. You have not chosen one side or the other. And so that's where this really all started for me, was that I feel like a person that I like to find that privileged perspective of sitting on the fence. And so I realized that, hey, in order to really sit on the fence, sometimes it's very easy to get there and sometimes it requires a lot of work.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's just an interesting, fun way to think about navigating problems. And also something that I try to do, which is, again, how do you find yourself sitting on the fence? Because that is a privileged sort of perspective. When you're on one side of a steep fence, you don't see the other side, right? You're in the environment, you're in the space of one particular choice and not the other. And the only way to get to the other side is to input a lot of work in order to get up and back down to the other side. Or maybe there's something like intellectual gates that we can build and engineer, which allows you direct access right through the fence.
Okay. I'm really like starting to understand, but I like to get a bit more examples. So I want to first get an example for you of a fence that was very steep, but that you ended up climbing. And then afterwards we can get the cheat codes.
Oh, okay. A very steep fence
that you ended up sitting on.
Well, and here's the other thing. I will try to answer that question. It's that part of where this came up for me was that I was realizing a lot of the really steep fences, it required that same amount of work for me to get back up there again each time.
Yeah. Yeah. I recognize that.
So for me, my background, a lot of the sticking points for me are sort of computational and trying to wrap my head around how computation maps onto the real world. And so things like the concept of zero and infinity and putting myself firmly in one camp or the other and feeling really confident about what zero means and what it doesn't in terms of nature, I would say that's a very steep fence. And each time it sort of requires me to climb up there in order to see both sides in an honest way.
That's great. What about the intellectual doors? What you said?
Well, right. I think that's I lost your video here.
Keep talking. I'll fix it.
I was thinking to myself, is there a way to get to the other side that doesn't require climbing over? And I just thought of the sort of very human activity of engineering to solve problems. And a gate is something that that happens in fences. We use gates, right? We use our fences to sort of designate a particular area that we want to close off or create a boundary around. And but sometimes we want access to what's inside and outside, and so we use gates. We don't require ourselves to climb over the fence every single time. And so maybe an intellectual gate in a steep fence is something that you engineer for yourself over time. It's sort of an intuition pump, or maybe even a mantra, or maybe, again, a little analogy, a little visual analogy, or some sort of, thought experiment, right? A little sort of intellectual game or routine for yourself that allows you to go there quicker.
Yeah, I understand. I think you can also lay out the map for yourself because you're talking about also fences you've climbed before. Mm-hmm. So I really like this concept of teaching yourself, like leaving little trails for yourself to figure it out again. Because it's always, for me, it's so, I don't know, it's kind of annoying when you've done so much work and it's like, oh, wait, I actually have to go all the way back up. But there's really ways, like I do that with notes on books all the time. But sometimes I make so few notes that I look at them and I'm like, what? what did I even write here? Like, I don't know. I don't even remember, even with recent ones. So, yeah.
Yeah. Do you have any, you asked me like if there's any steep fences that I've been on. You're just encountering this little, thought game. Are there any things that you sort of have to constantly like work towards to keep both positions in mind? That's like that position sitting on the fence. You have both positions in view. Is there anything that you
I
can
don't
think of?
know if it's applicable, but I don't know if you know, but I think about Bitcoin a lot.
Okay.
And that's like, it may sound kind of surface level to some people, but it goes pretty deep. And in order for
Yes.
me to, yeah, and I was on Karen's channel speaking about it, and I had to explain it to her, and I didn't expect her to ask me the fundamentals, you know? And I'm not a technical guy at all, so I had to like think about it, and I had a lot of trouble explaining it, even though I think conceptually I have it kind of understood in my head. And then I realized, like, yeah, whoa, I have to go back up. So then I went back and I spent a lot of time like understanding the fundamentals again. So I don't know, you correct me if it doesn't apply, the analogy of the fence, but
I totally think that applies. I think it could be, like I said, fences can be short or very tall, right? And just a decision itself, it almost seems applicable to me on this fundamental sort of, again, a dichotomizing of this and not that, of any decision is sort of implying a this and not that, even if it's slightly complex.
yeah, I think with my maybe my example doesn't apply as much because the decision is not really as much there as it is with you, because you mentioned the zero and the infinity. And I don't know, with Bitcoin, I don't really have that thing to choose from, but I can understand the intellectual challenge of reintegrating
Yes.
the knowledge I used to have. But I don't know if I have a fence example, a really tall one at least.
Maybe, a better than the fences. Again, the fences is I'm aware of the simplification of dichotomizing, right? Whereas a stronger analogy, which is more complete, might just be something like climbing a mountain, right? Where you climb the mountain and you're privy to the perspective and the views that you gain by gaining an elevation or whatever it might be. And there are certain processes that you go through to get up to that perspective and sort of back down on the ground level where you have to, again, you have to put your foot on the ground somewhere, right? You have to step on one side of the line, or one side of the fence. And maybe on the mountain, it's more complex is that there's different, regions or, well, even with a mountain, it's like, your view of the top is different based on where you're standing at the bottom. It's almost obvious, right? If I'm standing on the north side of the mountain looking up at the summit, it's a different view than when I stand on the south side and I look at the same summit, right? And
Yeah,
so
no, I feel you. But when you're on the top, you've known the bottom perspective, which
exactly.
that's such a cool thing about the analogy. I think that works really well.
Yeah, and we could go, you could go, I'm not the first to do this, right? This is the sort of the cyclical journey of, you could think of the hero's journey like a mountain climb, right? Where you leave where you're at on the ground and you go out and come back, right? There's many thinkers and people who have contemplated the nature of our psyche, who think of things in these sort of ascent, descent, right? Or go away and return, or start and come back to the starting place.
It reminds me of the cave.
Or the exactly. That's what an amazing drawn out story about that sort of process, right? Where my fence one is like the simplest.
Yeah, but defense, I feel like, is it not different, yours though, because you have the two sides in a
Yeah, I
sense?
thought so. I guess so. I could think of like inside the cave and outside the cave as two perspectives to hold in that story. But there's that sort of complex, scenery within Plato's cave that makes it so much more rich, the people making the shadows and the chains and the it's
Yeah, it's wild. I completely read over it the first time I read it because I made this mission for myself when I was 19 to just read all of Plato. So here I went like speed reading it, and my brother was like, "Oh, did you learn about the cave?" And I was like, "What are you talking about?" He's like, "The cave." And like, yeah, I must have read over it. And it's like, wow, the ignorance is just on a different level.
Yeah, I had an interesting thought about Plato's cave once. Well, I've recorded this somewhere else. Remember how I told you about little sketches that I've done that
Oh, I remember
I
very well, yeah.
put in a pile?
Yeah.
I also have a giant pile of recording myself talking, just to talking to myself, you know, just letting everything go, doing my own podcast with nobody, me questioning myself.
Yeah.
And I went on a long rant about imagining the process Plato went through to eventually write down Plato's cave.
Oh, wow.
Well, because I mean, any story, right? He didn't have the story complete and then say, okay, now I'm going to write it down word for word. There was some sort of development that must have happened, right, in creating all of those different pieces and weaving them together and weaving together a narrative, but also a diagram. You know, that's what is very interesting to me about Plato's cave, is that it also includes a sort of technical diagram in a certain sense. And so yeah, how did that come to be? I thought was so interesting. And then I realized, I wonder, maybe if I understood Plato better, and if anyone is like an expert in Plato and they know that something else he wrote sort of indicates this, but I always wondered, did he have the realization that his allegory was written from someone who was chained to the wall, being himself, right? That he's describing these characters who are chained to the wall, looking at the shadows on the wall, and in place of human beings, right? Him being one, and him being one of those people that in that predicament still wrote the allegory of the cave, right? So it's interesting. I wonder, you know, what does a story or what does an allegory look like from you know, the perspective of being outside the cave or something? But
Matt, I find it so. I just think about this idea of like the imaginal process that you speak about of these writers, and I almost forget that they were even like human,
Yes.
So I would really want you to actually explicate a bit more about this process, because what do you think it was actually like? Because you spoke about it to yourself. I'd love to hear a bit more.
So I question it. I think about just myths in general. How did these stories come to be? The origin of myths is very interesting to think about. Especially when it's something that seems to have occurred through many people over a long period of time. So, yeah, I wonder. I think about there's some intuition, and then there's some intellect. There's some of the ingredients are sort of rationalized and problem solving and sort of picking up on patterns, sort of like pattern recognition in the happenings of their experience. And then some of it must be pushing beyond that, because the stories and the myth definitely are pulled away from direct experience to a certain degree. If not just because they're written down, there's also this deep, deep idea of maybe this is a really steep fence. What's the difference between an idea that's written down and an idea that's not written down?
Written down, not written down.
I think there's a fundamental difference when something is finally recorded.
Yeah, because you're saying written, so also like spoken out, spoken into existence.
There's some symbolic representation,
I think
but
it's, yeah.
also, go ahead.
No, just thinking about it, because I know that a lot of people conceptualize ideas as coming to us, or in some sense, like we are receptive toward the ideas. And then once we've recorded them, in many ways, the ideas are like, yes, we made it, you know, like we made it here. So that's one way of thinking about it. But please let me know what your thoughts are.
No, I think, you know, I'm just distinguishing at least two categories, yeah. which is like intellectual, intellect, where you're sort of thinking it, and then the intuition, which seems beyond what you already know or what you already have an intelligence for or an intellect for, or you already have some established thought or idea about. Intuition is this sort of impulse tugging at you, you know, to go beyond that a little bit.
Yeah.
Or maybe instead of going beyond, it's going a little bit deeper.
Mm-hmm. I think they both work.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
Like the deep.
Okay.
Because my girlfriend and I often speak about the difference between going within and like moving forward or up, because I prefer she's a yogi, so she likes to go inside. That's really what speaks to her. Mm-hmm. And I'm so outward focused in many ways. Like I'm thinking about my potential self, you know, the Peterson talk and all these things. But I think they point to something similar in a sense. You can conceptualize it at East versus West as well, you know, the different types of relating to transcendence.
Absolutely. It's reminding me of something that I just learned recently. Mm-hmm. I just heard recently, but it really fits in. And it's the same idea of, are we reaching out or are we going inward? And so someone was talking, I can send you maybe the link of the conversation. It's another great YouTube channel. It's led by a man named Layman Pascal. And I think his channel is called The Integral or something like that.
I'm subscribed, actually. Is it the guy with the orange stuff? He's got like a Buddhist thing behind him or so.
Sometimes he has
that. Yeah, I know him.
Yeah. And he talks with people sometimes from like, if you know the channel Parallax or.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. Alexander Bard and Daniel Schmachtenberger and those types of people.
Mm-hmm.
And he was having a conversation with people in the field of like self-help or just developmental psychology, personal growth, like those types of things, even therapies. One of the perspectives he was trying to highlight was the usefulness of not always having something outside reaching for that we have to run to, that we have to grab, that's bigger than us or better than us or an improvement, right? Or fixing a deficit or something like that. And to do that, we think we go somewhere else out there to sort of change ourselves to that we are imagining, right? Mm-hmm. It's like a future sort of better state of myself, right? Or I've rid myself of this deficit that I have, right?
Yeah.
I think that probably works for some people in some cases for some things, right? We have to sort of just...
exactly.
But instead he was saying, and I really love the sort of, well, I just think he's choosing a really great word to describe an alternative to that, which is you have to unfold yourself.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
That's excellent.
And so when you unfold these layers, right, then you're seeing what's deeper, you know? And so you're sort of seeing things for the root of the problem, maybe. Although mm-hmm. he was also saying we shouldn't necessarily identify it as a problem necessarily, right? Because what we feel as a problem on one level, at a deeper level is a solution, right? It's like deep in our psyche for some reason. Maybe it's protective, maybe it's coping, maybe it's, I don't know, right? But just labeling it as a problem or deficit may not be seeing it for what it originated as, which is something that was meant to be helpful or, again, protective or something like that. So unfolding and sort of recognizing what it truly is can be a really interesting way to think. And this is my own little extension on this, because I was very interested in origami when I was a math student. And when you unfold something like an origami structure, you're sort of increasing its range anyways, right? When I have something that's all folded up and compact, right? Not only do I see what's covered by unfolding it, but I actually have a bigger reach
as
well anyways, which is what you were trying to do when you reach out and grab for that better self.
Exactly.
When you run to that new place, it's like you can reach that other place not by running there, but by unfolding, and then you are there.
Yeah, that's excellent. It also feels like it's less effortful in a way. It's at least a more natural way to get there, you know?
It's a release of sort of tension, right? There's sort of tension that's being creased into these folds. You know, I'm literally imagining like a piece of origami that gets folded over on itself and creased and smashed down. And when you unfold that, you have this sort of wider structure. And yeah, the crease pattern is also there, right? And so you see the history of how you were folded up and compressed.
It's a beautiful image. I really see it so visually, like really sad. Like I wish there was like I wish someday, you know, these things you're talking about will have like a visual on top of it. I don't know if you've ever heard of the after school. Have you seen it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'd love to just see him do it. This is really, really impressive stuff.
Agreed. I wish I knew like artists. Oh, well, I do know some artists, but artists and digital artists that would want to do a project where they create some of those visualizations. Some people have such wonderful skill with that. And especially with computer graphics nowadays, people can do really cool animations. I have a couple others that I would love to see visualized in like a really like hyper realistic animation. It would be so neat.
Have you seen the Wolfgang Smith, you know, the cosmic icon in a documentary they did? It is like really cool. Did you see it?
I did see it.
Yeah, it's dope. I really like it. It's really impressive.
It is. That's kind of what I'm talking about is, you know, he had somebody really work with him to make that beautiful, you know, and well done. Just like, yeah, so.
Awesome. I feel... like I'm so curious. I mean, I know we have a certain amount of time, but like there's a lot of ideas I want to unpack. How do you feel about the fences one? Is there anything you'd love to add? Because I'm really curious about the one you mentioned at the start as well.
Okay. Are you anything else on steep fences? No, I've also thought of just similarly like deep trenches. You know, it's just sort of the same idea as the steep fence, and it rhymes, and it's just going down instead, you know? So it's like, in order to find like the treasure at the bottom of a deep trench, right? You have to climb down and then climb back out to get there. It's just the sort of the mirror reflection of a steep fence in a certain sense.
Is there a way in which it's different
I think it could be, you could play it that way as to like the downward going into some deeper place and the steep fence going to some higher perspective. If you like to sort of layer things or think of things in hierarchy where there's, you at least leave open the possibility of going down or going up.
What about the decision part? Because on the fence, you get like to go one way or the other. How is that in the trench?
In the trench, it could be on one side or the other, like a steep canyon, right? Yeah. Where you want to travel across, and that's where you could build a bridge instead of a gate, right? So the same sort of intellectual hack is available where you could build a bridge.
Yeah.
So that is there.
I want to say something about the fences because you know, I think every metaphor has, or I don't know if you would call it a metaphor or analogy or allegory, but they all have something that the other one doesn't have, you know, same with frameworks. Do you know if there's a way, like, do you know if there's something about the fence that has something that all the other ones don't? Or is it this, the decision thing that pops out to you?
Are you saying like, this little analogy is more complete than another type of analogy?
That's my question, basically. Yeah, is there something for me in using it that I don't get from the cave or the mountain?
I think that's probably up to you first.
Yeah.
And I don't think that mine is sort of better or anything. Maybe it's just you could use them interchangeably. I do think the gate thing is kind of interesting.
Yeah, that's cool. I think that's it actually.
I think that actually makes it a little bit unique where there's like, there are these shortcuts or portals or something like that, right? Like a gate kind of functions like a portal.
Yeah.
And so maybe that's something, although that sort of reminds me of this, like, you know, breaking through to the other side, lifting up the veil, you know, those analogies are similar in terms of like this instantaneous perspective change. So yeah, maybe I'm just in a humble way, I don't feel like it's super special.
No, but I like it. I mean, we got maps for a reason and they're different for a reason. Yeah.
And I thought of it, it would be a really fun, interesting, you know how some video games today are like, they're just like really open exploratory sort of like experiences. Like they would be very well suited for like virtual reality or something where there's not a lot of this like killing enemies or, you know, getting the star or whatever. It's like navigating and just it's more relaxing or puzzle like, right? There's these games where you even like manipulate the environment. I imagine this like video game where there's like this giant landscape and it's basically just it's like a maze of fences of different heights and different lengths, and you have to, you know, you're just sort of like trying to get to some endpoint at the end of the map by navigating all these fences, right? And it would be interesting of like, which do you climb over, which do you sort of travel around and try to find a corner. I'm thinking about like a 3D maze almost where you would be navigating through three dimensions. So I just thought that would be fun for like a game developer to design that, where you could just navigate an environment of fences and it was a sort of puzzle to try to get through the map.
Yeah, I like that a lot. you should work with one or become one.
Oh my god.
Let the kids learn, and then the fences are actually like intellectual challenges.
That would be cool. I had this like video so back when I grew up in the 90s, and so, you know, I didn't grow up with like smartphones or like the internet really. But at these places or like at the library in our neighborhood, they would have computers and they would have like pre-programmed like computer games that most people just didn't have in their homes. And there was really like educational ones where you were like climbing a mountain, you're answering math problems, you're answering logic problems, and you get little items and things like that. And you actually like climb a mountain and do all that sort of thing. So those seem fun. It would be cool to do like deep philosophical questions that you have to encounter in a sort of narrative, right? Or something.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I hope that's the future, because I don't think we're going to get the kids off of them. So might as well make them educational.
Gosh, you have, I mean, we don't have to go there. Maybe another time, but yeah, our modern digital and technological environment is a bit crazy to try to navigate and also just think about and sort of analyze, like, what's the point? What should we be doing? How do we use this? How does it get abused? It seems like such a big, important topic, but I know that it's like, those are long, deep conversations. And
I mean, to have with your spouse as well, I can imagine, with your children, because the parents growing up right now, I mean, now you kind of have an idea, okay, these are video games. I'm assuming that you're familiar with smartphones and all these things. But my parents growing up, they were going into it while they were raising. I think, a lot of people didn't really know what was coming. Agreed. And now I think we're only starting to get a grip on, like, how do I actually deal with it myself? And then your children are a whole nother pickle, let's say. But I'm seeing like a lot of parents taking the challenge head on. And like, for example, when I grew up, my parents would give us an hour of screen time for the longest time. And eventually they just gave up, because they got so integrated as well digitally. That was like, it was almost like hypocritical to be like, hey, you guys can use it, but I have to use it for work and everything else and all these things.
Exactly. So, it goes very deep. I mean, do you want to talk about it a little bit? I have
sure.
Many thoughts.
Go ahead.
Well, one thing is that this is very new. We have to really realize how new this is in humanity. And yet our well, our biochemistry is no different from, or maybe not no different, but very imperceptibly different from, let's say, 100 years ago, or even 1,000 years ago, I think.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
And so it's fundamentally changing our perception of reality. So here's a few examples, and you brought up children. This has, now that I have children, it's made it very top of my mind, you know, again, like you said, navigate it myself, but also now be responsible for young people who are really impressionable and developing their own habits and preferences and, you know, ethics and aesthetics. They're developing those. One thing is they're drawn just to the physical thing for a number of reasons, in my opinion. One, it's the flashiest, shiniest thing in the environment always, in a sort of unreal way, right? Even the screen of the cell phone or the tablet while it's off is almost like a jewel, right? Yeah. In its environment. It is a diamond, right? It is iridescent. It's a rainbow. It's, you know, and so even like my one-year-old is just drawn to the screen itself. Even if nothing's on it, or if something's on it, she doesn't know what's on it. It's just there. And it's a thing to go for in the environment. And so that urge to go and investigate or grab or be entertained by that thing starts really early just by exposure. And again, how many of us can eliminate that from our environment? It's very difficult.
Yeah.
The second thing is young children mimic what they see in a lot of cases. And adults, we have the cell phone in our hand. We talk into it.
Yeah.
We look away from the real world and look to the screen. That's an expression of values. Our actions are an expression of our values. And when we stop looking around the world and we look at our screen, I think we're indicating that our value in that moment lies within that shiny diamond. And children learn that right away, that these square rectangles are places for whatever my parents are doing, you know?
Yeah. Whatever.
And so they mimic that behavior. The third thing that I've encountered is now with my almost five-year-old, she's very bright. I think on the good side, technology is making kids so smart.
Yeah,
in certain ways. Sure. Their language, their ability, how many stories do they encounter? You know, they have these sort of more rich, like, I think about a five-year-old 100 years ago in, you know, whatever, the Midwest of America. They don't have a bunch of stuff going on in their day all the time. But like, they don't have a bunch of stories and cartoons getting thrown at them. But the young people, they're receptive to all of that, and they can follow the stories. They can learn from the stories. They can learn lessons, good or bad. So that's one thing. But also, my daughter, who's almost five, she's asking me multiple times now about what is real. Is that real? Mm. Is that a real place? Are those real people? Because she's encountering so many digital computer animated characters with human type voices and human type behaviors and stories. And then seeing like a real person, maybe singing a song, like a nursery rhyme or something like that on the screen, she's not able to always distinguish which one is real to her. And she, I think she knows what real means, like real, like her and I sitting in the real world, or she'll ask about real places. We watch, you know, one thing that we like to watch on YouTube is bakeries that make pastries and little confectioner things, because she loves baking with her grandma. She loves ice cream. She loves candies. And so she gets very into like, wow, this is how they're making rainbow bagels, or like, you know, all these little pastries and cakes and chocolate. And she's fascinated by that. But then she sees the real people doing it. But because it's on a screen, she's asking me, are those real people? Is that bakery a real place? So already she's having at least some struggle identifying what is real and what is not. And so that scares me a little bit for young people, because they're going to have to deal with those types of decisions and uncertainty. So yeah, that's not something that I dealt with, really. I knew what a cartoon was. I knew that was.
Yeah. But... No, I hear you. I mean, I grew up with a lot of this myself. I'm 21. So for me, growing up, I had a TV. I didn't have a cell phone until I was, well, I had an iPod Touch when I was 11. I don't know if you remember those.
I had an iPod with the wheel, with the spinning wheel.
Oh, epic.
And I had a Discman. That was most of my formative years, like in middle school. I had a Discman with CDs and things like that.
They're coming back, I feel. I was at like the biggest flea market in Europe yesterday. And it's really? They're just recycling. I think they're at the 70s right now, or the 80s. So I think in 10 years, they'll should be at the 90s. Or I don't know how those trends work, but yeah. I heard this about the cycles. But... But to go back, I mean, yeah, it's wild. I'm in an airplane and I see a little baby and the baby's crying and the parents just like, whoop, iPad.
Oh my
gosh. It's like, what are you doing to this child? Like,
It's very prevalent. I'll tell two little stories again that are a little bit meant to shock us, I think. I think that's actually the purpose of these stories. So it's not very fun to tell, but... I take my daughter to a class, maybe it's a dance class or a swim class, and there's a little waiting room right in between classes. Kids are coming out, families are waiting to come in.
Mm-hmm.
And I've found myself often in the waiting room of the dance studio, and I am standing in the middle of the room like I do as a weird person, and I'm just looking around, and I see that nobody else is looking up, literally. It's shocking sometimes that no matter the age, everyone is down on a device, and the teenager is on the ground with his coat over his head with a tablet one inch away from his face, and the toddler is trying, being consoled, on their mother's knee, and the mother's holding a phone in front of their face, or the dad is sitting, cross-legged, and he's doing his scrolling on whatever it is. Or even during like a swim class, when I'm like so focused on my daughter swimming, and I'm not saying I'm special and there's other parents that are doing that, but so many parents like in the stands are doing their own thing. It's almost like their free time to do their scrolling and whatnot. And maybe there's a reason, maybe they're doing work, maybe they're reading. So there's no real judgment there. It's just an observation that people are detaching from what's happening out in front of them and going into the shiny diamond screen.
Yeah, and it's attention. I think you pinpointed it very well when you explained you did it from basics, which I really like. Like you also go into the perspective of the 1 year old seeing the shiny diamond and seeing the parents do it and being like, okay, the parent does this, so let me do this. And it reminds me of Peugeot's idea of attention, which is like it's such a primal thing. Like we can speak about what we believe, like on a propositional level, but what we do is more important, especially to a 1 year old, because speech is a whole different thing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you give that example, it's really wild. But it also makes me think of like, okay, so we are actually worshiping our phones in many ways, or whatever our phones are supposed to represent. And I've heard it before, like I've heard it said, but now that I really visualize it, it's really starting to land. That, I mean, the idea of worship. And why Peugeot thinks it's so, Jonathan, why he thinks it's so important that you go to a church. Because I really had him tell me, but I didn't integrate it. But now I really see it, because it's also something you mimic as a child. And at the same time, it feeds back into your reality and what you deem important in action. Yeah,
absolutely. And all I can say also is that just put myself out there and say, like, this is something that I personally struggle with too, which is feeling this sort of, and now a sort of a guilt about my use of my own device, right? And it is something that I struggle with personally, whether my amount of hours or appropriate or abusive use matches up with anyone else, I have no idea. But it's something that I sort of think about. It's like, wow, I go on YouTube more than I want, why don't I get caught up with my earphones in listening to all of these things and writing comments and all of that. And it's a detachment from the real. Can I tell my other little visual for you to scare
Please do.
You?
Please do.
Okay. Another part of this story is something that I've gone through in my past. So have you ever thought about the struggle of doing art or taking photos?
Yep.
Okay. So there, I think at the end of this, we arrive at that place, but, it's like a detachment from the reality. It's a detachment from the lived experience. So the other visual that I have to scare us all is this, you know, Cristiano Ronaldo?
Of course.
Of course. So recently he, you know, made a massive change and went to the Saudi Arabian Soccer League. So that happened, what, maybe a few months ago now? I can't remember.
Yeah, something like it.
Let's just say it was a few months ago. So a few months ago, when right after this happened, a video popped up in my YouTube feed for Cristiano's, like, one of his first games. And it says, like, Cristiano scores a penalty to win the game or something like that, right? And so I'm like, I got to see this. I got to see the highlights of Cristiano in this new league with this new team and whatever. And the broadcast is all, you know, professionally presented and everything, just like you see in Premier League or Dutch League or anything like that, La Liga, Bundesliga. And so they show Cristiano coming up to take his penalty. He's lining it up. He scores. He runs to the corner. He does his amazing, you know, celebration. The crowd is going crazy. And then they go back to the replay, right? And they show in slow motion Cristiano's face getting ready. He runs up. This is the most tense moment, right? The biggest soccer player in the world taking a penalty, a special moment in soccer where sort of like the game stops for once, you know, and like there's one thing that happens. So the reason that I'm building this up is like, this is in recent time, one of probably the such a heightened moment in soccer, Cristiano penalty kick in a new league with a new team. Then they show in the replay, a slow motion image of the crowd behind the goal.
Oh no.
And in the stands, in framed up on the TV broadcast is maybe 100 people. I had to pause the video to check myself. Every single person in the frame, every single person was looking through their cell phone. And you can imagine that in most of the stadium, maybe this was happening. So my point is, what do we value? Do you value the experience of watching Cristiano Ronaldo take the penalty kick? And even think about these Saudi Arabian fans. Like, it must have been so special to have Cristiano on their team and like, oh, Cristiano's going to take our penalty, but I'm not going to watch. I would rather record it on my cell phone. So that so that you share it on your social media, so that you go back and you look at it again later, so that you can send it to family or friends. It's somehow we've lost sight of the enjoyment of watching the thing happen. That is scary. That even in the most heightened moments, we will choose to go through our little tiny shiny screen and miss out, frankly, completely miss out on something that we will never get to see again. You will never actually look at Cristiano taking that penalty kick in his first game for the Saudi Arabian team. You'll never get back. You missed it. And we're willing to do that more and more. I scare myself when I do that with my own children, when I want to take a picture of the cute thing that they're doing, or I want to document the amazing first steps or the whatever, and even just in a good-hearted way to share it with my wife or share it with my family members, my brothers and sisters or my parents. But the fact that we have that available, it also makes available the opportunity for us to detach. And it's a little bit alarming to me that we do that so easily, with so little resistance, in a reflexive sort of way.
No, absolutely. And I've seen this example many times of parents with kids in parks. You know, it's kind of dystopic, but I really do see at the same time a counter movement, which is quite encouraging, of people either stepping away from it completely or finding a balanced way to do it. Or because it's really true that we're just getting this thing. Like, it's like when people were just exposed to cocaine, I can imagine. I mean, everyone's on cocaine. I remember watching Narcos, and you just see like everyone at the party is doing okay because they don't know what it is. Like, they're just trying it. And I mean, phones working on a dopaminergic level are basically like that, I feel, if not worse, especially for children. And I think, yeah, you're getting to know the territory, and then maybe in a generation, the culture will start to adjust as to how to deal with these things, because they're so strong in potential, you know, and it's like, oh, so yeah.
You're so right about the potential too. And I also agree, in my hopeful side, I am hopeful that we will sort of swing back from the extrema that I think we're sort of either approaching right now, or as you said, some people are starting to sort of recognize, whoa, we need to swing back a little bit.
Yeah.
But the potential is also so difficult because, again, we said this before, we're able to do this. Here we are at our screens, right? And we're not the first to recognize this. It's like the potential is so powerful. It's like our technology is allowing us to attempt to cultivate wisdom more than we ever could in a certain way. I still wonder if this is a little trick for ourselves, that all of us that are doing this are going to end up in some dead end. Or that if it's not balanced with some of the traditional sort of wisdom seeking, then, oh, I think for sure, if it's not balanced with sort of traditional wisdom seeking, that this will, it will be lacking in some way, or it can lead to sort of abuse, right? If,
yeah,
because, yeah, again, this is, we still, I think, rely on some of those more ancient systems, even just in the way that our body reacts, right? The state of my body is different when I'm in a Zoom meeting than when I'm sitting quietly outside with a pen and paper, right? It's just, it's a difference. It's a different way of being. And so, yeah, we have to try to navigate using this technology well and not forgetting or losing out on the more ancient ways. I've often thought, here's a really not humble thought that I've had. Am I smarter than Plato? I think that to myself sometimes.
Are you?
Well, I try to think about that and I say, well, I have access. I have the privilege of all of Plato's works and all of the analysis of Plato's works and all of the extension and synthesis of thinkers after that, right? And I'm able to take in all of that knowledge that I guess Plato didn't have access to. And so in that sense, like, am I beyond where Plato was? That's the one side, the non-humble side. And yeah, I think that can be justified just in terms of, if you want to put it in terms of like information, right? That we know so much more information than Plato did. Mm-hmm. It seems that way, right? So on one hand, I want to agree with that, but then I immediately try to throw myself out of the way and say, but all of that extra information that I feel like I'm accumulating sort of in the context of ideas and evolution of philosophy, where I feel like I'm beyond Plato, I must be, I know what Plato knew and more, right? That's one way that it feels. And then I say, but wait, what have you missed out on? The lack of having that information is also an opportunity for different information that now I don't have access to. For example, here's a very simple one. When I use the term light, this is from Matteo Peugeot. When I use the concept of light, I cannot help but think of light bulbs and fluorescent light bulbs and electricity. And maybe my knowledge about light goes even deeper to photons and where we are in relation to the sun and how electronic circuits work and Ohm's law, and right, I can't remove all of those extra layers of context. And because of that, does that sort of obfuscate a concept of light that you can only get if you aren't sort of jaded or shaded by all of those extra layers of light on top, right? Yeah. Where light in the Bible, they didn't care about photons, right?
Yeah.
There was no quantum physics necessary to use light in a meaningful way.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wonder if I don't have access to that. And so in that sense, maybe I can't be, you know, as intelligent or as smart or wise as Plato, because I'm sort of already biased by my yeah. modern concepts.
So. I think we're talking about intelligence and wisdom. I think if we're talking about IQ intelligence, I think there are not a lot of people that are coming close to Plato. At least I've heard Trevecki say that he thinks that people estimate Plato's IQ to be like beyond anyone recorded in modern history.
I wonder how they do that. I wonder what kind of thought processes they go
through. I thought so as well. Like, I'm not sure how you would even begin. But
it doesn't seem wrong to me, though. I mean,
and wisdom. I mean, there's no way in which I think amount of information seems to correlate or cause wisdom. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely, 100%.
Yeah, so that's why I would never even think I would come close to Plato. But in terms of information and things we know or we can know, yes. But then at the same time, I think like because of my phone, I've become much lazier with remembering things. Like I've decided to store them on my little phone. And then I look at my notes and I'm like, I don't remember this. I don't remember that. And it's like, okay, so maybe I know something, but actually my phone does.
Mm-hmm.
So just exported my information somewhere else to my second brain.
Oh, definitely. Discernment, right? It's like you lose, and nowadays we sort of lose even to a certain extent our ability to trust the digital information that we encounter. It becomes more difficult to sort of
verify
exactly.
And who's going to be the verifier? That's the question I hear all the time. It's like, okay, now the government's going to tell us which is real, which is not. Or someone else.
I think we're reaching some limit for ourselves. And again, even just in the results of like, are people happier and healthier with all of this extra information and knowledge and technology? It's an open question of, and maybe it's just a personal thing that you have to try to navigate. Again, it's like, what is appropriate for you?
Yeah.
What is meaningful?
I think it's, go ahead.
That's all.
Okay. I think it's I look at two sides of it, because on the one hand you have like the person who is really consciously navigating this world and picking the information that they want, like they're reading Plato on their phone, and you know that's the exception, absolute exception. And if the majority of people will get bombarded with news, just so much more news than they would ever get if they were growing up in like some village 500 years ago. And the amount of negative, alarming things that they get into their system is just crazy. So in that sense, I think people get way too much information.
Yeah, exactly. And not always the good kind, right? Like we talked about this sort of the egregores or the demons last time of the medias. Media that we absorb and that we encounter. Yeah, very true. It's such a double-edged sword. And how do you wield that sword sort of responsibly is it's such a challenging practice in today's world, again, which we don't have a lot of context for. We don't have like Plato and Aristotle weren't giving us any advice about how to deal with our addictions to smartphone media.
But they gave us virtues in a sense, or at least they helped us cultivate them.
Yeah. So, right. And do you think that trying to twist those, or at least the sort of the meta idea of virtues in general, is something that people would benefit from?
What do you mean twist?
Well, I sort of mean apply. Okay. I sort of mean like spin a little bit to the modern predicament.
No, that's for sure. For sure. I mean, the way I look at something like wisdom is that it applies to all situations. So even if they were speaking about being wise back in the day, of course, I think it can be applicable. The word that comes to mind is sophism. I think Vicky spoke about it, something to do with temperance, for example. I think you could definitely apply it to the digital age. I think the question goes, though, like, you need to have food in your body. Do you need to have much of the technology at all? Like, do you need to be temperate with it? Or do you need to just banish it all out? Because I had a time of life where I would just, like, I deleted all my social media. And it was quite a cleansing thing. But then just the demands of working anywhere in my country or going to school, it's just, you need a smartphone, even just going to the store nowadays for us.
Yeah, exactly. It's embedded in our existence. Like I said, it's like, what job can you have today without an email address associated with it?
Yeah.
Right. It's like, you can't survive without an email address. That's unusual.
That's unusual. Unusual
for a human being. It's like, in order to keep my family safe and secure, I need an email address.
Yeah.
And that's a little bit strange. So
I'll tell you a story about my friend. She got a flip phone just in the middle of the school year. Like, oh, you got a flip phone? Like, I was like, okay, that's gonna last you a week. And two weeks later, she was back to her iPhone, because like, you can't do it. Just, you can't do it.
I know. Yeah.
But you can live. Yeah, go ahead.
No, go for it.
You can live in a way that's completely detached, but it's just like, it's funny actually how much I speak about this with friends of mine. Because I think a lot of people are starting to have it in the back of their heads, like, okay, but could always live on the farm in Peru. It's like, it's not for a lot of people, but it's something people are now longing for. That's their escapism in many ways.
It's, well, there are two sides to this. In one way, I want to warn those people that it can be ill-advised to sort of fantasize that, because there's a really harsh reality to, well, how far you want to go to, like, live off the land or live off the grid or whatever. And depending on what goals you have in your life, I mean, there's a reason that most cultures have gone past that, right?
Exactly.
We are where we are because people over the years have wanted to go beyond that. So when we assume that, like, we want to go back, it's like, why didn't the people back then want to? You know, obviously they were longing for something more advanced. But yeah, maybe again, we've swung a little bit too far. It's something I think about too. And also, as you know, a little bit of my story, I've attempted to, like, go that way. And so I do have some, like, direct experience of, like, again, trying to live without technologies and modernity and things like that. And in one sense, I found it difficult, even for a sort of single, young, free person, right? And most people just aren't in that position. You have, like, a short window of time, I think, in your life generally, where you're old enough to do things on your own, but you haven't reached a place where you have other, you know, you don't have a family or children or things like that, where you can't just, like, decide to buy a one-way ticket to go live on the island. Right? Like, you lose that chance if you're being responsible. But there can be big payoffs.
Yeah.
Sure.
But I'll repeat what I said the last episode, though, and that in many ways I find it very special, the digital age. And I think a lot of what I'm seeing is that short term, it's just going into a pretty bad direction. But the promise of these technologies have always been in many ways liberating. And that's why I think a lot about these topics like Bitcoin and decentralized technologies. Like, I feel in many ways blessed with them because they allow for more opportunities and sort of leveling the playing field in many ways. Because I feel if you really want to learn something nowadays, like you said it before, like, you can learn so quickly and almost completely for your cost. Like, most books you can find online, So in that sense, it's quite beautiful as well, but it's learning how to deal with it and then learning to harness it and that's where I think the wisdom comes in. And I do think it's applicable, to go back to your question. So yeah.
Yeah, most definitely. Yeah, I wonder who, you know, I wonder if there's like good models out there. You know, I wish, for me, it's like, I want to see somebody who manages that well. I want to see what their family is up to.
Yeah.
And what sort of like practices, you know, Verveke is big on just like create a practice for something, whatever it is, right? Create a little bit of community, the logos, the practice. Like, how do I practice that in my life? Who can give me advice on that? Who can show me the way of like, yeah, it's, so I don't know, maybe it's you.
But I think we will see like emerging communities like this. I think we really will. I think that people will be more and more longing for, well, I already see it actually, people longing for communities. My girlfriend's really into like watching vlogs of people, and she follows a lot of young people that are walking this middle path, like a couple living in the US and having their like little chickens and little farm, but not completely swearing off modernity and making a living off off of content creation and working with the digital things, so that gives them some freedom, but at the same time they really want to be connected. And I hear people really wanting community and realizing that life is not all about them. Which is something I think you went through as well, and I went through. So yeah, I think we can start to go back to our humanity and things that are really foundational to it, and they're within, and we can maybe let them unfold.
Well, that's great. Maybe, and I think this feels to me like a natural. I really like this positive ending of like, hey, we can try to create practices to utilize our technology and our modernity. So I will think about that more, because I have to go here in just a few minutes.
Yeah.
But I wonder if we can think of, you know, offline, if we can think of some actual practical things. You know, a lot of books sort of make these suggestions for practices somewhere like at the end of the book, you know, it's like, how do you apply this to your real life? Or like go through this exercise, right? Or like, you know, Peterson's self-authoring thing. It's like, ask yourself these questions, write down the answers, you know, or maybe fill in this chart, you know, identify goals and things, you know, just going through a sort of a learning process to try to materialize or formalize some of these things in our lives. Maybe we can come up with a few good ideas. So that would be really interesting.
I think we will. And I'm glad to see also the guys move into this direction. The people in this little corner of thinking about AI and all these things. It's like, okay, we're in this kairos. As Verveke would put it so well. And it's like, we got to put some wisdom into this thing, because this machine is going somewhere right now, and I don't like the direction. So we do have some agency, and I'm excited to
agreed
to help it steer the right way.
My final comment, and I'm gonna have to jump off, we got to talk again, obviously.
Of course.
I was thinking about this like this little corner thing, and from just like a, like I still consider myself like a rando, you know, like when I think when I reached out to Karen originally, I'm like, hey, I'm probably another rando person just reaching out to you. Where, you know, I don't feel like I have a position like in this little corner. Those people seem like, you know, off in the distance, or like they're on the board of directors, you know, Verveke, Vanderclay, Grim Griswold. I don't know if you know Grim Griswold.
No.
the Sunday, what is it? The Sunday Nameless. I can't remember. There's some of these other like sort of orbiters of, well, I don't want to say it in a pejorative way, but like orbiters of Vanderclay and Peugeot and things like that. You know, I just don't like personally feel like I'm a part of that quite yet, you know? And I was thinking about like, do I fit in, or
do I kind of feel
like, no, here's actually, it's a little bit better. I feel like in terms of this little corner, I feel like I'm in that little corner.
Oh.
because I'm in this other corner over here where I'm looking at all of the things going on in this little corner, right? I still feel like a little bit of an outsider, which is okay. I'm like, I love to talk. I would talk to anybody in this little corner, but yeah, I still feel like I have a slightly different perspective, and maybe just like my preferences and my interests are slightly like orthogonal to this little corner, but there's so much crossover. And so like building bridges is something that I'm interested in. And so I wonder if just like, yeah, like maybe like some people might take up another little corner over here, that little corner over there. And, you know, then the corners can start coming together.
And there's a little fence between the corners and you're just jumping over the fence, crawling.
Or are we going to fold it, right? We'll
bring yes.
together by folding it.
And that's awesome.
Fold and see the crease patterns from our enfolding and unfolding.
That's great, Scott. I don't want to steal you any longer. Please apologize to your children, your wife. Yeah, it's been great. I really want to talk again, of course. We'll fix it up offline.
Yeah, we'll send a bunch of notes and then we'll talk about one or two of them.
Oh no, yeah, like I think we'll do one note per episode. But I'll get started on the books. I've got four to go. So we'll take a while.
Yeah, but, check out the Enneagram. I would be really interested to
see. Is that the first one you want me to check out?
I think so. It's really fun. It can be really fun and really deep. So I would love to just like hear what you have to think about it. Definitely.
You don't have to
force it where you're like, oh, Scott thinks this is going to be really deep. You know, it's like when you tell somebody this is the best movie ever, you know, and then it's for them, it's not.
It will just be what it is.
Or if you want to critique it, if you want to say, I'm not so sure about this, I would love that. Because yeah, it's not perfect. It's not everything, but it rings true in a lot of ways. So
yeah. I'll let you know. You can let me know your availability and we'll just set up the next one.
All right. Awesome.
All right. Have a nice rest of your Sunday.
Great to talk to you again.
See you, Scott. Great to talk to you too.